Security assessment and testing are critical components of any information security program. Organizations must accurately assess their real-world security, focus on the most critical components, and make necessary changes to improve. We will discuss two major components of assessment and testing: overall security assessment, including vulnerability scanning, penetration testing, and security audits. We'll also discuss testing software via static and dynamic methods. Security assessment and testing provides a mechanism for validating the ongoing effectiveness of security controls, with a variety of tools to validate those controls. These tools include vulnerability assessments, penetration tests, software testing, audits, and security management tasks. Every organization should have a security assessment and testing program defined and operational. Vulnerability assessments use automated tools to search for known vulnerabilities in systems, applications, and networks. Flaws may include missing patches, misconfigurations, or faulty code that expose the organization to security risk. Penetration tests uses these same tools but supplements them with attack techniques where an assessor attempts to exploit vulnerabilities and gain access. Penetration testing strategies include war dialing, sniffing, eavesdropping, dumpster diving, and social engineering. Tests that involve human interaction analysis will increase costs but are more thorough. Software testing is used to validate code moving into production. Software testing techniques verify that code functions as designed and does not contain security flaws. Code review uses a peer review process to formally or informally validate code before deploying it into production. Interface testing assesses the interactions between components and users with API testing, user interface testing, and physical interface testing. Static software testing techniques include code reviews, evaluate the security of software without running it by analyzing either the source code or the compiled application. Dynamic software testing evaluates the security of software in a runtime environment and is often the only option for organizations deploying applications written by someone else. Fuzzing is a testing technique that uses modified inputs to test software performance under unexpected circumstances. Fuzzing also modifies known inputs to generate synthetic inputs that may trigger unexpected behavior. Generational fuzzing develops inputs based on models of expected inputs to perform the same task. Security managers must perform a variety of activities to retain proper oversight of the information security program. This includes log reviews, account management reviews, backup verification, key performance, and risk indicators. Log reviews, particularly for administrator activities, ensure that systems are not misused. Account management reviews ensure that only authorized users retain access to information systems. Backup verification is the most important and ensures that the organization's data protection process is functioning properly. Key performance and risk indicators provide a high-level view of security program effectiveness. Internal and external audits conduct or facilitate internal and third-party audits. Security audits occur when a third party performs an assessment of the security controls protecting an organization's information assets. Internal audits are performed by an organization's internal staff and are intended for management use. External audits are performed by a third-party audit firm and are generally intended for the organization's governing body. So first and foremost, what is footprinting? Footprinting refers to the process of collecting as much information as possible about the target system to find ways to penetrate into the system. An ethical hacker has to spend the majority of his time in profiling an organization, gathering information about the host, network, and people related to the organization. This information includes things such as IP address, who has records, DNS information, and operating system use. As mentioned before, footprinting is used to find various types of information. This information includes IP addresses, who has records, DNS information, operating systems, email IDs, phone numbers, technical resources such as network information, applications, device information, administrative information, and physical details such as location data, facility data, people details, and social interactions. Overall, footprinting helps to know security posture, reduce attack area, identify vulnerabilities, and draw a network map. Knowing security posture, data is gathered that will help you get an overview of the security posture of the company's details, such as the presence of firewalls, security configurations of applications, and other things. Reducing area attacks can identify a specific range of systems and concentrate on a particular group of targets. This will greatly reduce the number of systems we are focusing on. Identifying vulnerabilities can help to build an information database containing vulnerabilities, threats, loopholes available in the system of the target organization. In drawing a network map, can help to target organizations covering topologies, trusted routers, and the presence of servers and other information. Next, we have footprinting methodology. There are various methods used to collect information about the target organization. They are footprinting through search engines. This is a passive information gathering process where we gather information about the target from social media, search engines, various websites, and others. Information gathered includes name, personal details, geographical location, login pages, intranet portals. Even some target-specific information like operating system details, IP details, net block, technologies behind web applications, and others. These all can be gathered by using search engines. These search engines include Google, Bing, DuckDuckGo, etc. Another methodology is Google hacking. Google hacking refers to the collection of information using Google Dorks by constructing each search query with results finding sensitive information. These details include compromised passwords, default credentials, competitor information, and information on particular topics. So first and foremost, what is sniffing? Sniffing is a process of monitoring and capturing all data packets passing through a given network. Sniffers are used by system and network administrators to monitor and troubleshoot network traffic. Attackers use sniffers to capture data packets containing sensitive information such as passwords and account information. Sniffers can be hardware or software installed in the system. By placing a packet sniffer on a network in a promiscuous mode, or malicious intruder can capture and analyze all the network traffic. There are two types of sniffing, passive and active sniffing. Passive sniffing is the process of sniffing through the hub. Any traffic that is passing through the non-switched or unbridged network segment can be seen by all machines on that segment. Sniffers operate at the data link layer of the network. Any data sent across the LAN is actually sent to each and every machine connected to that LAN. This is called passive, since sniffers placed by the attackers passively wait for the data to be sent and capture them. So the first network attacks we'll go over are denial of service and distributed denial of service. A denial of service attack floods a server with traffic, making a website or resource unavailable. A distributed denial of service attack is a denial of service attack that uses multiple computers or machines to flood a targeted resource. Both types of attacks overload a server or web application with the main goal of interrupting services. The principal difference between DOS and DDoS is that the former is a system-on-system attack, while the latter involves several systems attacking a single system. There are five main differences between DOS and DDoS attacks. 1. Ease of detection. 2. Speed of attack. 3. Traffic volume. 4. Manner of execution. And 5. Tracing of source. With ease of detection, since a DOS comes from a single location, it is easier to detect its origin and sever the connection. In fact, a proficient firewall can do this. On the other hand, a DDoS attack comes from multiple remote locations, disguising its origin. With the speed of attack, because a DDoS comes from multiple locations, it can be deployed much faster than a DOS attack that originates from one. The increased speed of attack makes detecting it more difficult, meaning increased damage or even catastrophic outcome. With traffic volume, a DDoS attack employs multiple remote machines, which means it can send much larger amounts of traffic from various locations simultaneously. This overloads a server rapidly in a manner that eludes detection. With manner of execution, a DDoS attack coordinates multiple hosts infected with malware, creating a botnet managed by a command and control server. In contrast, a DOS attack typically uses a script or a tool to carry out an attack from a single machine. And lastly, with tracing a source, the use of a botnet in a DDoS attack means the tracing the actual origin is much more complicated than tracing the origin of a DOS attack. Countermeasures for DOS and DDoS attacks include firewalls, routers, intrusion detection systems, intrusion prevention systems, disabling broadcast packets from entering and leaving, and disabling echo replies. Botnets, controllers, and bot herders represent significant threats due to the massive number of computers that can launch attacks. Botnets are a collection of compromised computing devices, often called bots or zombies. Bot herders are criminals who use a command and control server to remotely control the zombies, often use the botnet to launch attacks on other systems or to send spam or phishing emails. Denial of service attacks can take many forms and be used for various means. It can be to make a company lose business, to cripple a competitor, to distract from other attacks, or simply to cause trouble or make a statement. Denial of service attacks prevent a system from responding to legitimate questions for service. Common denial of service attacks include SYN flood attack, Smurf attack, and ping of death attack. SYN flood attacks disrupt the TCP three-way handshake. Smurf attacks employ an amplification network to send numerous response packets to a victim, and ping of death attacks send numerous oversized ping packets to the victim, causing the victim to freeze, crash, or reboot. Some more common types of denial of service attacks. So when dealing with network attacks, it is very, very important to know the order of the three-way handshake. It comes up commonly in discussions of TCP/IP-based network attacks. For example, the SYN flood attack exploits the TCP three-way handshake as follows. The attacker floods a victim site with SYN packets. The victim then responds to each SYN packet with a SYN ACT packet. The attacker does not respond with the last portion of the handshake, an ACK packet, leaving the victim waiting for a response. Then the attacker continues to send the victim SYN frames with a spoofed address. The victim then continues to attempt sessions with the attacker, allocating resources to accommodate each of these inbound session requests. So many resources are allocated that the victim cannot process a legitimate inbound request for a TCP/IP session. Another type of network attack is called eavesdropping. Eavesdropping is simply listening to communication traffic for the purpose of duplicating it and/or extracting confidential information. It's difficult to detect because it's a passive attack. Some countermeasures for this is to maintain physical access security, encryption in transit, and one-time authentication methods. Another type of network attack is impersonation or masquerading. This is the act of pretending to be someone or something you are not to gain unauthorized access to a network or system. Impersonation attacks also usually imply that authentication credentials have been stolen or falsified in order to bypass authentication mechanisms. Some countermeasures to stop this attack are one-time pads, token authentication systems, encrypting traffic, and employee awareness training. Some other type of network attacks are DNS attacks. DNS attacks include DNS poisoning and DNS spoofing. DNS poisoning is when an attacker alters the domain name to IP address mappings in a DNS system. They may redirect traffic to a rogue system or perform denial of service against that system. DNS spoofing is when an attacker sends false replies to a requesting system, beating the real reply from a valid DNS server. Some countermeasures for these attacks include allow only authorized changes to the DNS, restrict zone transfers, verify forwarders and all log privileged DNS activities. Another type of DNS attack is a homograph attack. A homograph attack leverages similarities in character sets to register phony international domain names, also called IDNs, that appear legitimate to the naked eye. A way to mitigate this risk is to update your browser regularly. Also on the client side, modern browsers that use puny code can stop it. On the server side, use policies implemented by ICANN. Another form of a network attack is hyperlink spoofing. Hyperlink spoofing is very similar to DNS spoofing. It can take the form of DNS spoofing or just simply be an alteration of the hyperlink URLs. It's usually successful because people just click on any and every link. Ways you can mitigate this risk is by using the same precaution used against DNS spoofing in services that mask and test links in detonation chambers. The OSI model, or the Open Systems Interconnection Model, is a conceptual framework used to describe the functions of a networking system. The OSI model characterizes computing functions into a universal set of rules and requirements in order to support interoperability between different products and software. In the OSI reference model, the communications between a computer system are split into 7 different abstraction layers. These layers include the physical layer, the data link layer, the network layer, the transport layer, the session layer, the presentation layer, and the application layer. The OSI model was created at a time when network computing was in its infancy. It was published in 1984 by the ISO, and though it does not always map directly to specific systems, the OSI model is still used to this day as means to describe network architecture. So the first layer we'll look at is the physical layer. The physical layer is the lowest layer of the OSI model, and it is concerned with electrically and optically transmitting raw and structured data bits across the network from the physical layer of the sending device to the physical layer of the receiving device. It can include specifications such as voltages, pin layout, cabling, and radio frequencies. At the physical layer, one might find physical resources such as network hubs, cabling, repeaters, network adapters, or modems. The second layer of the OSI model is the data link layer. At the data link layer, directly connected nodes are used to perform node-to-node data transfer where the data is packaged into frames. The data link layer also corrects errors that may have occurred at the physical layer. The data link layer encompasses 2 sublayers on its own. The first, media access control, also known as MAC address, provides flow control and multiplexing for device transmissions over a network. The second, the logical link control, also known as LOC, provides flow and error control over the physical medium as well as the identifies line protocols. The third layer of the OSI model is the network layer. The network layer is responsible for receiving frames from the data link layer and delivering them to their intended destinations based on the addresses contained inside the frame. The network layer finds the destination by using logical addresses, such as IP addresses or internet protocol. At this layer, routers are crucial components used to quite literally route information from where it needs to go between networks. The fourth layer of the OSI model is the transport layer. The transport layer manages the delivery and error checking of data packets. It regulates the size, sequencing, and ultimately the transfer of data between systems and hosts. One of the most common examples of the transport layer is TCP, or the Transmission Control Protocol. The fifth layer of the OSI model is the session layer. The session layer controls the conversations between different computers. A session or connection between machines is set up and managed at layer 5. Session layers services also include authentication and reconnections. The sixth layer is the presentation layer. The presentation layer formats or translates data for the application layer based on syntax or semantics that the application accepts. Because of this, it is at times also called the syntax layer. This layer can also handle the encryption and decryption required by the application layer. The seventh layer is the application layer. At this layer, both the end user and the application layer interact directly with the software application. This layer sees network services provided to end user applications such as web browsers or Office 365. The application layer identifies communication partners, resource availability, and synchronizes communication. So next, let's look at common network devices. Network devices include firewalls, switches, routers, and gateways. Firewalls are essential tools in managing and controlling traffic. A firewall is a network device used to filter traffic. Switches repeat traffic only out of the port at which the destination is known to exist. Switches offer greatest efficiency for traffic delivery, create separate collision domains, and improve the overall throughput of data. They usually occur on the OSI model layer too. Routers are used to control traffic flow on networks and are often used to connect similar networks and traffic flow between the two. They can function using statically defined routing tables, or they can employ a dynamic routing system. They occur on layer 3. A gateway connects networks that are used differently for network protocols. They're also known as protocol translators, can be standalone hardware devices or a software device. Network gateways also work at layer 3. Some other common network devices are repeaters, concentrators, amplifiers, bridges, hubs, and LAN extenders. Repeaters, concentrators, and amplifiers are used to strengthen the communication signal over a cable segment, as well as connect network segments that use the same protocol. These all take place at layer 1. Bridges are used to connect two networks, even networks of different topologies, cabling types, and speeds, in order to connect network segments that use the same protocol. Bridges take place at layer 2. Hubs were used to connect multiple systems and connect network segments that use the same protocol. A hub is a multi-port repeater. Hubs operate at OSI layer 1. LAN extenders are a remote access multi-layer switch used to connect distant networks over a WAN link.
you.